Namaste. My name is Nirmala Vev, interviewing Mr. Thyagarajan on behalf of the Foundation for India Studies for the Oral History Project, being done in partnership with Houston Public Library and Houston Community College. Welcome, Mr. Thyagarajan and Mrs. Dhanalakshmi Thyagarajan. And I know that you have come here to this place so many years ago. And we would like to know, can you please tell us the way, what inspired you and what motivated you to come to this place?
And like most Indians, you come to the state to study and go back. So that is the same intention I had, just to come here and get your PhD and go back to teach. I used to be teaching before I came. I was teaching at Annamalai University for 5 years. So I came here hoping that will happen. That didn't happen. I didn't go back. I have been telling my wife, you'll be going back, going back, going back. Then when children grew up, they told us, if you want to go back, you go back. We are going to stay here. Because for them, this is their mother country,
right,
not India. So if the children are going to be here, you might ask, well, there's nothing you can do about it.
See, these days there are so many ways of traveling to India. And today you decide that you want to go tomorrow and you just buy the ticket and you leave. But tell us about the way how you came here and how long did it take?
I used all modes of transportation, from bullock cart to train to ship and a small vessel to cross the channel and then plane. And it took me 1 month. August 2nd, I believe I left, and September 1st, I reached New York.
Almost a month?
Almost a month. Because in those days, there was no direct flight from Bombay to New York. So I had to use this mode of transportation, and that was the cheapest one possible. It cost me about 2,000 rupees at that time. That is equivalent to $300.
2,000 rupees.
In 1961, yeah.
Tell me something about your experience when you're traveling in a ship. Were you allowed to bring a lot of things?
Well, there is a limitation. You know, you can bring so much. But luckily, I didn't bring much except clothes. Because they provide the food and all those things. And we are going to a new country, and I didn't want to carry anything, get into trouble, this kind of thing. So, but luckily in the ship, on those 26 days in the ship, I had a good company. There was a pastor, Catholic priest, he was with me, who was the one giving me the moral support. And there was a chess player, was related to a famous one in Madras, Manuel Aram. He was one of the champions in those days. So I was able to spend the time usefully, and also some confidence in me. That pastor gave me a lot of confidence. He has been traveling between the United States and India several times a year. So it went beautifully.
So that tells me you came alone at that time.
I came alone.
And your wife joined you later?
5 years later, yeah. 5 years later.
Can you give us some kind of background, your background and your mother tongue, especially your mother tongue and where you come from? Because you said you had used all kinds of transportation, starting from bullock cart to all the way to
yeah, right.
An airport.
No, so my hometown is Thiruvaru. That is famous for two things. One, the Carnatic Music Trinity, all those three were born in Thiruvaru, but they moved away, but they were born there. And also the Chief Minister, former Chief Minister, Karunanidhi, he was born in Thiruvaru. And it is, the temple is famous, Thyagaraja Temple, that is how we got the name. All the first sons used to get that name, in most cases,
yeah.
If you are born in Thiruvaru. I have three sisters and two brothers. I'm the oldest in the family. My father was a teacher, and he broke the tradition because we are used to be business people, either farmers or business.
What kind of business?
Wholesale, grocery merchants kind of thing. But my father broke away from the tradition and became a teacher. After that, in my family, almost all of us, except my sister, we were teachers.
Very good. Education.
And of course, my sons, they didn't follow. No. Both of them are doctors. One is a cardiologist. The other one is just a family practice. They are married to, we speak Tamil. That is my mother tongue. They are married to Telugu girls, two Telugu girls. And I thought that was wonderful because if the girls who speak the same language, there will be less problems.
You know, that takes me to my next question. Basically, I'm a Telugu also. My husband is a Tamil. Now, how did you meet your wife? And I'm sure, you know, your mother tongue is also Tamil, or?
She's related to me.
Oh, okay.
Her father and my mother are second cousins. So her father, I would address him as uncle, mama.
Okay.
I think in Telugu, I don't know what term
Telugu
they use.
It's also mama.
Mama. Okay. So it is a marriageable relationship between her and me.
Okay.
But first time I laid my eyes on her was on the day of the marriage.
There you go. Love is first sight.
All right. Okay. Let us put it that way. You work at it.
Right. And your daughters-in-law are Telugu.
Telugu.
And you are Tamil. So how do you think the life is taking now with them, with their children, your grandchildren? What kind of language do you...
They all speak English.
English. But they understand Telugu. They can watch movie. They understand Tamil. They
your grandchildren or...?
Grandkids and daughter-in-law and
right.
Son. My kids, they will speak Tamil. But when they grown up, we don't have, now Christian have a lot of music class and Tamil class, so many things.
Language classes.
But 66, 67, you know, we don't have anything, but we live in Prairie View, so we don't have anything to do. Now I am so impressed, you know, my kids grown up this time, maybe they'll learn a lot, you know, but too late, but my grandkids, they have a chance to them. But we can teach them our culture, but my kids, I will teach them for money value, cultural value. That's the way they learn. But now that helped me a lot.
You came in 60s. Was there any kind of cultural shock to you, or how did you manage with your Indian culture? With an American culture, did you have any kind
of... Well, see, there was only black and white movies, but some of the shenanigans that go on now, you see in the late night movie. Okay? See, whenever I see something like that, I close my eyes or go to my room. I say, my God, what is this? You know, why we came here and all that. And then, you know, slowly you get used to it, and because you have no other choice, don't watch those things. But today it is much, much worse than in those days. There was a culture shock, you know. Whenever people kiss in the streets, it was a revulsion. You know? It happens even today, but you are not that sensitive anymore. Maybe as you get older, you are desensitized.
So, since you are a housewife, and tell us about what kind of things you used to do in early 60s, and how did you manage at home for cooking and all that? Was the Indian spices and other things were available at that time, and what did you do?
Well, sometimes my father used to say, take a 6 months, some Britannica biscuit container that comes up, everything mixed up. So I told them to stop everything. So we go around all the downtown area, any store and what they have. Finally we manage, you know, so spicy, then we ordered from New York. And then we find out one lady, J Store, they started. So we are so happy, but we come here every week and get anything. But very hard to find the Indian vegetables.
Yeah.
And even though fresh coconut, green pepper, very hard to find. So it is very, I want to go back because of
the
food. I don't eat cold anything, no ice. I can't take it, cold milk or anything. Yeah, I'm so scared everything in meat, you know, so anything mixed with that.
So both of you are vegetarians?
She is perfect vegetarian, even today.
Okay.
I am spoiled.
No, you shouldn't say spoiled, but then you are able to.
I eat
now
even.
He become a vegetarian, but...
Our family, well, traditionally, is vegetarian family. Yeah. We change.
Incident like 9/11, that incident, did it have any kind of impact on your personal life as well as your business,
yeah.
Whatever?
Definitely. Yeah. It hurt us so bad. You know, how crazy people can be to do this kind of thing. How much hatred you must have inside to do this kind of thing. Those guys, they were willing to give up their lives to destroy 4,000 people. This is very difficult to believe. Now, I was asking myself, what is it in the religion that tells you that you can do these things and still go to heaven? I cannot understand that. It was a big shocker. Now, I was teaching at Prairie View at that time. It was around 8:30 or something that happened. So I was trying to make some copies of a paper from the class. I saw this, yeah, and I was telling my friends, you know, colleagues sitting there, hey, what is it, you are watching TV now? Then the second plane came and hit, and I realized, my God, it is very shocking.
And can you tell us about your involvement with the Indian culture? Your involvement with the temples or about your sports?
In the beginning, 1974, the only cultural activity is to have some movies and some music, you know, Carnatic music. In those days, if 30 or 40 people show up, that's a big deal.
Okay.
There is not that many people. As a matter of fact, when we moved to Prairie View to teach, the only other Indian who is going to be interviewed next by Vatsa Kumar, Dr. R. Nasrao, he was the only other Indian. Okay. The numbers are so small, whenever we show movies, you have Telugus, Tamils, Kannadigas, Malayalis, all of them will be there, even Vernu. Okay. Their family, everybody is there.
Yeah,
that, yeah. Because, of course, the movie may be in Tamil or Telugu. But these are the people, because they may not know what is going on, but there is company, you know, that gives you time to talk to people. So that is how it was at that time. Then in 74, we decided maybe we have enough people to start an organization. And that is how Bharati Kalai Mandiram came into existence. You know. In a sense, you know, it happened in my house. Kannappan, Harir Swami, Vishwanathan, these are the prime, myself. We are the
founding members.
And in 77, Kannappan wanted me to help in this Meenakshi Temple thing. It all happened by accident. You know. And then Meenakshi Temple came along. So I served BKM as president twice. One is 1977. In 1990, and Meenakshi Temple, 78 to 82, and then 93 to 95, two times. And also, interestingly, my son was also on the board 4 or 5 years ago. He was the first American-born Indian to be on a board, religious board. He was the first. Yeah.
Do you have any kind of concerns now, looking at this community versus our Indian community getting into the mainstream. And whether we think that we have problems in letting them know about our culture, or is it a smooth sailing? What is your opinion?
Well, it is not going to be a smooth sailing. You are going to have conflicts. But sometimes I wonder whether our Indian culture is any different from American culture. Because some of the things you see on TV in India, I was wondering whether it was a reflection of life in India. Our life is a reflection of what goes on TV. Because we have the nightclub scenes are there, all those things are there. So, and also majority culture is going to dominate. You know, however much you try to bring your culture to the kids, you know, the majority culture is going to influence. There's nothing you can do about it.
And can you tell us about your support to any particular organization? You mentioned about DKM. Other than
DKM,
the
like
corporate businesses
temple,
like in the Hillcroft and other places, do you have any kind of...
Oh yeah, well, we do shopping there. So in that financial sense, we help. And ICC, whenever they need, they ask for some help. We are not active, we are not very active. We are more active in DKM and Mirage Temple.
You told me that your sons are physicians, and they were born here. So do they ask any questions about our Indian culture, or do they have any kind of conversation or a debate? Have you ever had that experience?
See, whenever I tell them our culture is great and all that, then they are going to come up with some examples and say, what is this? This is what is happening there.
Not only sons, now grandsons.
They also. But they imbibe some of the Indian culture. Once in a while he would ask me why we are doing this, why we are doing that. For some questions, I don't even have the answer. Because we do certain things by rote. Because the priest says, do this, you do it. And we don't know the reason why we are doing it. When the kids ask you that question, but with my sons, I used to tell them, okay, forget it. But with the grandchildren, you cannot do that.
And you need to explain it to them.
You have to explain. Otherwise, they will tell you, Tata, you don't know.
They go to web and they find out.
And any kind of unique experiences you have had in your workplace as an Indian?
Okay. I worked in three places, one in Washington with the federal government, and in Mississippi, that is also federal government, and then finally at Prairie View, which is a university. Okay, in the first two, I have interactions with the white people, community. Of course, blacks are also there, but mostly white. At Prairie View, it is all 95% of them students are black students. I got a good name as a teacher, and also I try to help. There are weak students, you know. All students are not alike. Some of them are smart, some of them are not. So I try to spend some time, at least 1 hour for 3 days a week. I used to have special classes. And with the result, you know, as a human being, they like me. And also as a teacher, I was tolerably good, I believe.
Sometimes we go to mall or some place, they ask me, hello, you remember me? They come and ask me, you forgot I am your student, you teach me this year. My son going to now that Prairie View. I think he is my grandson, is my son, you know. And I'm so proud of him, someone remember him.
Actually, a teaching profession is a very, very noble profession.
Yeah,
and I'm a teacher myself.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And I'm a Montessori teacher, and absolutely, you're absolutely right. And you know, that's why you're teaching, you don't know where it stops, it goes on.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, you don't teach, if you're teaching 1,000 people, from 1,000 people, they are going to teach 1,000 other people. So it goes on. You have a very noble...
I had a very good experience. I have one student, that was 2004 or 2003, I'm not sure. That student said, Mr. T,
you are recording.
You came in the early 60s.
61.
Now, 61. And when you came to Houston, how was Houston at that time and what kind of changes do you see now?
Well, in 61 I came to University of Tennessee, Knoxville. In 67 I came to Houston. 65, 67 we were in Jackson, Mississippi. That is where Ram was born, and all the black power and all those things were taking place at that time. You know. I have seen Martin Luther King three times, his speeches I have heard. You know. That is a turbulent time in Mississippi. But when I came to Houston, this area, in 67, it was not that bad. But still we were nervous. Because you don't know which restaurant you can go, whether there is going to be any problem, this kind of thing. That was there. You know. The only place we knew at that time was Pizza Inn. That is where we would go every weekend.
But as you compare 67 to 2012, the world of Houston completely changed.
And also people's attitude, everything has changed.
And then old Houston, you cannot see any old building, old highways, everything now new, and the economics, you know, everything.
To come to the temple, you came on what is called the Hempstead Highway,
right,
and take 610, go around,
right,
Cullen Boulevard or Cullen Parkway, then take the 518, McLean Road and Temple.
Take 2 hours.
Days.
As an immigrant, did you encounter any kind of racial or color discrimination? Any kind of experience you have
in
had?
Mississippi, yes. In Washington, D.C., none.
Tell us a little more about it.
In Mississippi, before she came, I wouldn't go to a restaurant because nobody would serve me. And there was a hamburger place called Crystal Hamburger. There you go in, buy and get out. And of course, there is no restriction there. But in restaurants, I had a bad experience once. I went there, sat there for about 20 minutes. Nobody came to serve me. So I decided not to go. After she came, we wanted to try, see how it was. So I would push her to go in first. She would go in. Then I would open the door and get in. They didn't know what to do with me. The people who had seen me before and the way they treated me, now they don't know how to deal with this.
Is it because of
Because of her sari, the way, yeah. She was wearing the sari. They knew she was foreigner. In my case, they had wondering where I am from, you know, this kind of thing. After that, it became somewhat easy in Mississippi. We can go to some restaurants, and she became somewhat of a familiar figure in saris. Because when we go around the mall area, people have some idea who this person is. There are no Indians in that town, Jackson, Mississippi. But after coming here, it was a fear that restricted us from going to many places. But over a period of time, things were not that bad here. And also, where I worked, it is mostly blacks, okay? So you have no reason to interact with white people. But there were some boys who were working there. So we didn't have a very bad experience in Texas.
Since we are talking about races, what do you think about interracial marriages?
Whatever my opinion is, it is coming. You be prepared for it.
That is sure. You just have to say your opinion on that.
Yeah. My opinion is, you know, as if it counts, thank God my children got married. So now I have to worry about my grandchildren. This is what I used to tell my older son, Ram. She was very particular. He married somebody who speaks Tamil. I said, hey, as far as I am concerned, any South Indian girl, okay. If that is not possible, any Indian girl is okay. If that is not possible, you do anything. Yeah? There is nothing much I can do at that point. So it is coming. And there is one experience I had in Mississippi. You know that Tugaru College professor? There was an Indian guy who married a black girl. That is one of the solidest marriages. You know? So, you never know. There are Indian marriages, I have heard, not doing that great. Yeah? And there are international marriages, they are doing great.
So maybe did that change your mind?
Definitely. If suppose my grandson says, I'm going to marry this girl, what am I going to do?
That's not your opinion. That's
that is, yeah, of course, that is another thing.
So that parents' problem, they don't know if you want to stay that long or not.
No, this is how I would say, you know, spend 1 year. If you still want to marry that girl, it's okay, go ahead. See whether it lasts that long.
Now let's talk about sports. Where did you play any sports in India?
I am what you might call a jack of all trades. I play everything, average yes. player. Except cricket, tennis, I play almost everything. I'm badminton, Indian badminton, that is a different kind. I used to be a good player, and ping pong also. I used to be, but not anymore, but in the old days.
Chess.
Oh boy, I forgot. Chess.
So after coming here, what did you continue to play here? What are the kind of sports did you continue to play?
Chess.
Chess.
Play with the computer.
And no, I get but he teaches chess for our grandkids.
Yeah.
Okay. Now that your grandchildren are old enough, do you go and watch their sports?
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Sometimes we sit and watch. Basketball, I can watch and enjoy. Okay. Football, I was never able to understand the game. And baseball, it is a slow-moving game, but I watch. You know, the grandkids are there. Yeah. Basketball, I really enjoy.
My
it is fast.
My kids play tennis and baseball and basketball at school.
So you must have taken them to all those
games. Oh, yeah, yeah.
So
they love it. I watch. Almost all games the kids play, I watch.
And
because that is the only chance.
Grandkids are playing tennis tournament. Then he used to go and watch all the tournaments.
So is it because they are whether your children and grandchildren, or do you go there to watch the sports as sports?
It is grandchildren.
Grandchildren,
and sometimes
we need
them play, and you want to encourage them. You know, sometimes the fathers are not very good encouragers. If the kid makes a mistake, you can see frown on his face. But grandparents don't feel that way.
Right.
So they always come close to you. You know, whenever they make a mistake after the game, they will come to you, go around you, but not.
That's a comfort zone for the children.
Comfort zone for them.
Okay. And do you have any kind of involvement with the political and religious organization? Of course, you know, you have.
Yes, political.
Political.
I am a Democrat. I don't know whether it is good or bad, but that is what I am. I help whenever the help is sought. Okay? Otherwise, I am not very active in the organization, in any organization. Precinct level?
Hemstead, I come.
Well, that is okay. In Hemstead, when I was in Hemstead, I used to be the vice president of Hemstead Economic Development Corporation. Okay, that is a corporation they created to bring industries. Okay. Hempstead is a very small town, purely agricultural, known very much for watermelon. It used to be called watermelon capital. No industry. Okay. So in order to bring industry, they created this organization. I was there for 5 years as vice president. And also I was there as one of the members of Planning and Zoning Commission, you know, to bring houses, apartments, approval, and this kind of thing. So that is where my many active involvement, if you call it.
Since you are a Democrat, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Okay. Who do you think is going to win?
I hope Obama wins.
Why?
Well,
why do you think that he should be our
president? Well, no, okay. His handicaps are quite a few. But normally, no president can do the job in 4 years. It takes 8 years. First, you have to learn the ropes. Unfortunately, when he came, he inherited a very bad economy, disaster. was waiting. And he is not very smart to bring parties together and get the job done. And already many Republicans hate him. Sometimes I wonder whether it is because of the race. Rush Limbaugh. I listen to him all the time. But that guy is venom, pouring venom. So it is my prayer right now that he wins. So he will have a second term. He can do a better job. Of course, the other team is a formidable team too. Because one is very successful businessman, the other one is ideology oriented person, and also he talks as good as Obama.
So your pro of his running mate?
Yeah, I like. See, you know, if he's a challenging guy, I like him. But doesn't mean I vote for him. That's a different.
Do you think our president has shown any kind of interest in the Indian community?
Well, he put quite a few people on job. Of course, they all left. That is another story. I think, you know, being a politician and president, he has to play a game. Okay? How far he will go, how much he will do, we have no idea. But my own feeling is, well, he has some sympathies for the Indian community.
In our local issues, what kind of issues really matter most to you?
You specify some.
In any issue, it doesn't matter, political or environmental.
Environmental, that is the big thing here. And if you drive around the Pasadena area, you cannot get out of the car and breathe. Because it was the smell, chemicals and all kind of thing. That's one of those things, you know, you need industries, but at the same time you have this problem. If you put restrictions on these emissions and all that, it raises the cost of the things. So it is a kind of vicious circle.
Do you think your grandchildren, they like to go back to India to visit, or do they ask more questions about India?
They may visit, but for a permanent settlement, I don't think so. Because they develop a bad impression as soon as they go there. They get sick, first thing. Once you get sick in a foreign country, you begin to dislike that country. It happened to my sons and also my grandchildren. Of course, once in a while, tourists, you know, to see Taj Mahal, things like that.
What do you think about all the Indian organizations here in Houston? There are several.
That is one thing that bothers me. It's a dilemma, let me put it that way.
Okay.
I want to have my own BKM. Tamil organization. And the next moment I asked myself, if there are so many language-oriented organizations, what do you call Indian? What is Indian? Now, wherever...
And I know you get involved in your temple.
Yes.
And also you are involved with your Tamil schools also, helping children, and you know, generally you are helping with everything else. And do you have any kind of issues about, if you want to change any kind of issues in the American system here, what would you change?
You are talking about the educational system?
About the educational system.
I don't know. I look at my children and grandchildren. Both of my sons, you know, they did very well in the high school. Because one, Ram is a valedictorian and the younger one was a salutarian. And grandchildren are also doing well. But the grandchildren are in private schools. My children went to public school, the county school system. Of course, my son tells me that in private schools, they are more demanding. In public schools, they are not that demanding. I used to tell him, yeah, you did all right. We want to spend that kind of money for private education. but he says it is better. I don't know what it is. But it looks like there is more discipline in the private school system. I don't know how you can bring that into the public school system. I don't know. Because so many things are happening in public school. People carry guns, 10-year-old, 12-year-old.
But you think that it doesn't happen in private schools because of the smaller
crowd number. And also more control, more discipline there. Probably they come from an upper crust, you know. So maybe that is great. You know, public school, you have all classes of people. In private schools, only who can afford.
Right. But as parents and grandparents, do you think we can have some kind of impact on the children?
Yes, of course. You can teach them some ethical values, moral values. You can do all those things. Because you are a grandparent, they will listen more than the parents. That is how it is. How much will stick?
We
have to wait and see.
We used to live in Prairie U, bring the grandkids from there and take there and bring it back. Take 1 hour, more than an hour to come here. But that time, he always teach them some math. Some question asked, he never turned the radio on.
That's wonderful.
And do them some problems.
Him some common question, how many cars going, how many cars behind, how much speed they are going. Some kind of quiz.
Education,
kids.
Always.
For his, our kids also, when we come for a shopping, we always talk about some question on the way, 1 hour, we spend the time. He always like teach the math or anything. My son always said, how come if I ask any question, you always give me the answer, you say, and you never say, I don't know, I think about it.
Exactly.
He never said, you always give the good answer.
Because he is an educator.
So he always like teach the kids, and they love, likes to listen to him.
I think it's been wonderful, you know, interviewing both of you.
Thank you.
And this is being recorded here at the Houston Community College. And the recording will be stored in our Houston Public Library. And thank you so much. And the last and final question to you is, what do you have for your grandchildren and children who will be looking at this from years?
Well, once it is ready, I will ask them to see and ask me questions.
Okay, but what kind of advice do you want to give them, or even not advice, what do you have?
Well,
you try
to instill in them certain cultural and moral values, ethical, moral and ethical values. They are almost common everywhere. But you know, you're drawing from your own sources, you can tell them, oh, these are good things to do. And as I said earlier, I hope it stays with them in all their life.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Namaste.
Enjoy.
Thank you very much.
Thanks too.